instructions and just note what to do and what not to do is Madam Nsenge Judith. She is a lawyer and also a board member with FIDA Uganda. Welcome to the show.
Thank you. Good morning.
Good morning. You're welcome. Next to her is Mr. Chivuna Moses. He is an associate at AB and David Advocates. He is an advocate and a family law practitioner. Welcome to the show.
Thank you for having me.
You're welcome. Yeah. I'll start with you, Madam Judith. Family conflict has always been around ownership of property, be it land, be it the tenure of someone who is deceased, and the people who are most affected, who seem not to have a voice in all this, are the women. Are we making strides to make that change?
Yeah, I would like to believe all these problems are stemming from the types of marriages we have, the women working or not working, the women having, the men having money, contributing most of the money to the resources to construct these houses, and the types of marriages we have, they are causing us a lot of what? Problems. Sometimes the women don't work. And society believes when a woman doesn't work, she's not making contributions.
So she doesn't have a voice.
She doesn't have a voice. Mm-hmm. But we are making strides. FIDA Uganda is making everything possible. If you look at the decision, the recent decision in the Turinawes, it has really interpreted more the issue of Section 39 of spousal consent, what is actually defining what matrimonial property is. And matrimonial, for example, the property that we women are really interested in is matrimonial property, the residences where they stay. Court has really defined, the government enacted the law, the Land Act, and defined what matrimonial property is.
Okay. So we're looking at avoiding. So when you say the types of marriages, then for someone who is not already married, which types of marriages should they not even think of getting into, and which one is the most ideal type of marriage? Because you're looking at first, how do we avoid getting into that mess?
Yeah. I wouldn't say there is an ideal or not ideal, because all the marriages, there are five, they are legal marriages.
Which one is high risk?
My own opinion, customary marriage is very, very risky, because defining family property in a customary setting is pretty difficult. It is pretty difficult if they don't have distinct homes, or if a man is wealthy, it becomes difficult in distributing that property. But in other marriages, like church marriages, civil marriages, it is easier to distribute property, because the law is very clear on probate, on letters of administration. But family property, when it doesn't have a title, it becomes difficult to distribute. Sometimes even customary property or family property is difficult. It has other owners that are within the extended family, like uncles, so it becomes difficult.
Okay, all right. Mr. Moses, just let us in on this one. In terms of avoiding, a marriage, for example, or this family, and I get to that point whereby I'm financial liquid, I'm financial empowered, and I want to get into acquiring property, and of course the children involved. How can we avoid this in the event that maybe my husband dies or I die? How do we avoid that? Should I now register all this property? Should I get a will? Avoidance.
To answer you directly, I think the most important thing that people need to do, first of all, whenever they're acquiring any properties, is to make sure that they're legally protected. That is, registering titles, for example, for land. And on top of that, registration and having documents that actually show you own these properties, you're supposed to go ahead further and include this in wills. Wills have stood the test of time. To protect people, to avoid conflicts, both civil and criminal, in relation to properties. Yeah.
So registering the property, going ahead and getting a will.
Yeah.
What's the process of getting a will, though?
It's actually pretty simple. You have to get a practitioner to help you draft these documents, because there's always a problem when people tend to draft them themselves. So what is best done in such scenarios is approach your family lawyer, for example, come up with how you would want to distribute your properties, so you draft the document, and after that you register it under the law. The Registration of Documents Act actually gives the mandate to the Uganda Registration Services Bureau to actually receive these documents and register them, mm-hmm. so that they can be legally enforceable when the time comes.
Okay, and is it expensive to
not really.
To register them?
Approximately, depends on your family lawyer though, but normally the range is between 50,000. It's not really so expensive. Mm. Yeah.
Between 50,000 and 50,000 what?
And it's endless. It depends on the lawyer. Yeah.
Okay, all right. Yeah. Madam Judith, is there any other, you know, aspect that you've not looked at in terms of avoiding getting into this family conflict over property?
The aspects that I've not looked at, there are very many mechanisms. Like my colleague said, of registering properties. Yeah. There are very many mechanisms of avoiding conflicts over property. We have the lawyers, we have the mediators, we have the courts, we have so many mechanisms. Mm-hmm. And we have the organizations that are not, the organization like FIDA, the Association of Women Lawyers, they are there to help mediate between parties if they get conflicts. Mm-hmm. In what? Disputes in property, especially families. Like that organization of FIDA that I work with, in their strategic unit, they mediate parties to resolve these issues.
Okay, and when you're still sticking to avoidance, does it help for couples or family members to be very transparent on the properties that they own and what is in the family? Because most of these things actually come to light after the key figure passes on. So does it help, Mr. Moses?
I actually think it does, because once you get to a level of transparency that shows trust, and when you have trust with someone, you end up not having disputes. So I think it's really very important that actually people are transparent in relation to if, for example, they are married, because there are coincidences where cohabitees actually want to still get also a title to these things. So it's always important that people are transparent, they let themselves know which status they are, if they are legally married or they are not, so that they can always have it in mind when it comes to such problems in relation to disputes.
And this is over and above having a will in place,
yes,
registering your property.
This is due diligence of sorts.
All right. Let's go into resolving. And we know we have two categories of families here, them that can afford legal aid and them that cannot afford legal aid. So, Madam Judith, let's start with them that cannot afford legal aid. And they're in this sticky mess of family conflict just because of property. What options do they have?
Those that cannot afford legal fees, they have so many options. We have so many legal aid service providers. I'll start with the Association of Women Lawyers, FIDA Uganda. They provide legal aid for women and children especially. And then we have Uganda Law Society. They have Legal Aid Project. We have so many.
For free?
For free. Mm-hmm. You walk into a legal aid service provider, and then you ask for legal assistance or legal advice, and they will advise you. And then we have the justice centers. Mm-hmm. They are a little bit affiliated to the state, to the government. They are national. So the mechanisms are there. The providers are there to get legal aid service providers.
Okay. And for someone who is maybe in Karamoja, far, far from Kampala, mm-hmm. what options do they have?
They have lots of options. For example, myself, the Association of Women, FIDA, gave me an opportunity to go and work there. We go and teach there. Mm. Yeah. These women organizations, they are doing a great job. They have offices there. Like FIDA has an office in Moroto, in even Kabong. It works Nakapiripirit, Kabong. So Karamoja is covered. Yeah. And Karamoja has so many organizations.
Okay, so even these units are spreading out to, you know, the people who are out of Kampala.
Yes.
Okay, Mr. Moses,
yes.
What options are there over and above these organizations that offer legal aid for free?
Yeah.
If we are such a conservative family and we don't tend our mess to be out there in the public, of course, once you approach a legal aid institution, everything is out there.
Yeah.
So for those conservative families and they cannot afford to pay for legal aid, what options do they have just to resolve that conflict
internally.
In secrecy internally?
I think the first thing that has to be done is the family has to come together. They should have regular meetings so that they try to resolve those disputes that may arise. However, there's always importance of a neutral party, and that's where I would actually encourage our people at FIDA, everywhere, even the legal professionals, even me as a family lawyer. So I would encourage us to actually go ahead to make sure that we intervene so that we act as an independent party to help them resolve the dispute internally. So meetings are very important. Secondly, I would actually advise these families to set up trusts.
Mm-hmm.
Trusts are mandated under law, you can actually create a trust. The way trusts operate is that you have a system that helps you organize, manage the assets of the family, and then you become accountable because the trust is held in benefit of the beneficiaries.
When you talk about trust,
yeah.
Just break it down for us. For someone who doesn't understand that legal
yeah.
term, what is trust? What are trusts?
A trust, so happens, if I'm to use an example, you have a family of four, with children and a husband. You go you create an entity, a trust. That's what it is.
Mm-hmm.
That legal entity that is incorporated has now the mandate to deal with all the assets of the family, to make sure they manage them in trust of the beneficiaries, which is the family.
And yeah. a trust can be someone in the law profession or someone who
is
not in a
law. It's a company. It's like a company.
It's a company.
Yeah.
Okay.
Yes.
All right.
So you register it. It's like an association of sorts, which is holding.
So that's an expensive option.
It's actually a very simple thing.
Doesn't need any money for
Yeah, it does need money. Mm-hmm. But at the end of the day, we are trying to resolve and make sure that we avoid these disputes that may arise. So I think the trust would actually help people on top of the wills that they should be making. And also, I would also encourage, as she said, mediation is really important.
Mm.
So if they can get an outside person, just one, so that it doesn't go out in the public, to help them discuss. That's why I said lawyers may be important in this process.
Okay.
Yeah.
And we know, especially in the rural areas, they so much give respect to their local leaders. And
yeah.
we're looking at, you know, religious leaders, the LC chairpersons. Any local leader is very paramount. So is it advisable to go for such, you know, people, such leaders to just mediate in their conflict in the families, Judith?
I think it is all right, but the local leaders are also governed by law. Their jurisdiction is a little bit restrictive, and there are limitations there on what kind of land property dispute they are handling. If it is customary, they can go ahead and handle it at the level of local council 3. But if it is registered land, they do not have a jurisdiction to handle such a dispute.
Mm-hmm.
So the best they can do is refer it to courts. And even if it is magistrate's courts, because other areas do not have high courts, they would be able to determine and refer it to a high court. What? Circuit. But for the local leaders, like you mentioned, we also work with religious leaders. We see also a very strong infrastructure in Gulu of Kekwal, for example.
Mm-hmm.
They can also mediate there, and they register whatever they've agreed upon the settlement. There's also a local leadership
infrastructure in Karamoja, for example. They believe in their local leaders. The government or organizations, development organization partners, are finding a way how to work with these people. They are still mapping it. Mm. Probably in the next 5 years or 10 years, they would have come out with a clear procedure on how to work with them.
Okay. Mm. All right. We've also seen very wealthy families, you know, go head to head over property. Yeah. So options that are quick for such, what are they? We can start with you, Mr. Moses. Is it just the law, the courts of law, and that's it? That's the only option?
The option in such a scenario is quite different. You see, what happens there is that you need to litigate. You need to go to court and then make sure that your claim is what is lawful, so that you can end up avoiding these disputes out of court, because they get bloody. So within the ambit of court, people get this sense of protection, this sense of justice. So it is actually quite important that they litigate such scenarios instead of trying to deal with it personally. Or alternatively, if they're not comfortable with court, they can go for arbitration. Mm. Arbitration or mediation, that is best. For example, SEDA. SEDA does arbitration for disputes. So I think that would be a better option if at all they don't want it to get so legal.
Okay. Yeah. All right. And Judith, we have families that have gotten into disputes, wealthy families. But even after the court, you know, gives its verdict over who is supposed to really own this property or how they're supposed to go about dividing it, most of them still don't settle. They still continue with the conflict. So if we have such verdicts being made in court, and family members are not comfortable with those, you know, kind of, you know, verdicts from the court, what options do they have to keep on following through with such?
There are two options. If it is a lower court, they can still appeal and appeal, second appeals, like we saw in the recent decision of the Turik Nawes. First appeal and second appeal to the Supreme Court. Mm. But even if you are not satisfied with the verdict, there is a process. They have to execute. They have to implement this judgment. You'll be dissatisfied, but there is a decision which is binding. So the parties, the successful parties, will go ahead and have this judgment executed. Those will just be sentiments, especially when the Supreme Court pronounces its decisions. Even if you are dissatisfied, there's nothing you can do about it. Mm. Maybe seek counseling. It is final.
Mm, it is final.
For the Supreme Court, right. It is final.
Right.
Yeah.
Whoa. So let's get into managing. So we've looked at avoiding. You've tried to avoid, but still you find yourself in that messy situation. We've looked at options for resolving, both for families who can afford, you know, legal aid and them that cannot. After resolving, be it through the courts of law, litigation or arbitration, how do we manage this? How do, because you can imagine coming from a bitter past as a family, how do you walk away from that and just get to the next level and relate as a family in a loving way and just move on? Is it possible? How do we manage this so we don't go back to where we were, Moses? I know it's quite tricky.
actually, it's a challenge. You see, once people have been in a dispute, they normally don't see eye to eye. So I think actually this is more of personal communications that need to be worked on. One, people need to manage this. People need to get into a space whereby they can have family meetings, one, because I believe it's really important that family meetings, for example, the whole extended family would easily help manage the dispute that happened and find ways to actually move forward. Secondly, if I'm to look at continued management, that is continuing, I talked of trusts,
right?
Yeah, I talked of wills. People need to be sensitized. So once they're sensitized, you find that their management of such disputes becomes different. they get to know which rights they have in relation to properties. For example, their uncles that tend to think that they are entitled to their brother's wealth, but they are not dependent relatives. So it is actually important that there's a little bit of sensitization before we get to the real management. Yeah.
Sensitization.
Yes.
Judith, over and above that, you know, just having these family meetings, of course, family meetings chaired by someone who is neutral and independent, and maybe creating trust and sensitizing people on the, you know, importance of having wills in place, registering their property. What other options do we have to ensure that this conflict is actually managed long term?
I would like to believe even the courts have tried to manage family conflicts in regard to properties. As you can see, we even have mediation at appellate level, at the level of Court of Appeal. Already there is a decision, but you are still given an opportunity to have a reconciliatory meeting and see how you can distribute this property. So the courts have really emphasized, please mediate. So at the level of the final decision, if you've not managed it, you have to look into yourself after the verdict and seek healing and reconciliation in your way. Because now the courts, the court officers, the lawyers have done their part. Because mediation is mandatory. It is part of the litigation process. You can't do away with it. By the time a case goes to trial, it has gone through
a lot of mediation
process. Yeah. So after the final verdict, it is about you. You have to seek reconciliation in another. And families should come first in need. I think as organizations, non-government organizations, we should come up with a procedure, a mechanism. How do we help these people?
Same goes for lawyers, actually, the legal professions. I think it's important that we also actually take on that role to help the families that are actually under our supervision due to the fiduciary relationships that we carry with these families. We should, I think, also have that in place. We help them manage their situations.
Okay.
So I agree with that entirely.
And you know, we can't have this conversation without looking at the bad side of the law. We have corrupt lawyers, corrupt judicial officers. If the verdict has already been made at Supreme Court stage where you cannot turn back the decision, what happens if I feel like for real the whole process was compromised? What's in it for me? What options are there?
Maybe what I can say as a lawyer who has over 10 years experience in this land property disputes, at appellate courts there is no corruption.
Really?
Yeah.
It's not there.
It's not there.
When a decision is given, even sometimes when you are handling an appeal, you are arguing an appeal, you already know the outcome. You go through the cases with the panel of judges, you already know the outcome. But it's a job, you have to do this job so that it is concluded. So at that level, those are panels. There is no corruption. They are looking at the substance of the case. They are looking at justice. There is no corruption at the appellate level. It's not there.
At least we have that assurance.
That's my opinion.
It's your personal opinion. So it's not
but
a fact.
It is not there, corruption in the appellate court.
It's a fact.
It is a fact. It is a fact.
Moses, do you agree?
I tend to disagree at one point.
Okay.
I do believe, we should believe that the judiciary is incorruptible because it's one of the foundational principles for the judiciary. However, you cannot leave the possibility that it is possible. You see? So in such scenarios, I think the best way to actually deal with such scenarios is to make sure that the civil society, the legal fraternity, everyone gets involved to make sure that justice is served. Because at the end of the day, we realize that if we can go international, we set a very good precedent. Yeah. So there is a possibility of corruption, okay, but we should trust the system.
We should trust the system.
Yes.
Interesting. Of course, that's been it for this particular conversation. We've forged solutions. As you come to a close, Judith, and also Mr. Moses, I just want you to hammer in on avoidance. What are the take-home points of us avoiding to get in such a messy state, Judith?
I think the take-home points, we should legalize our marriages. We should register the property. Legalizing our marriage, we saw this in the Chigongo versus Chigongo case.
Right.
The arguments there, the denials there, you're not my wife, you're not my husband, mm-hmm, that kind of thing. We need not to go there. Yeah. If we live as husband and wife, it should be legal. Because our parliament, our legislature, is not looking into yet the marriage and divorce bill to discuss the cohabitation clauses. Mm. They're saying no. Even the churches are saying no. So we still have a long way to the society to accept that kind of marriage of cohabitation. So my emphasis, I urge parties, I urge all the people to legalize their marriages.
Legalize the marriages.
Legalize their marriage, streamline the properties, and in the event they have conflicts, they should know where to take that. Even the Sharia courts, they also handle their stuff.
Okay. All right. Thank you, Judith. Mr. Moses, as we come to close.
I think everything to do with disputes starts internally, as personal. It's personal. So I believe the first thing to actually make sure that we avoid this is to make sure that people know the rights that they hold in properties. People need to know that they need to register their properties, as Shad's alluded to. Mm-hmm. People need to know that they need to protect their interests. Wills are very important. If they cannot do that, please let them go for trusts.
Okay.
They may be expensive, but in the long run, they're actually not.
Okay.
It's much more better than going into disputes that are more expensive.
All right. Yeah. Okay. Thank you so much for coming in studios. We've learned quite a bit. Madam Nsenge Judith, she is a board member at FIDA Uganda, and also she practices law at Nsenge and co-advocates. We also had Mr. Moses Chivuna. He is an advocate associate at AB and David Advocates, a family law practitioner as well. Thank you so much for having that conversation. The hashtag is Morning at NTV. Keep your views coming. Quite a sticky conversation, but like you've been told, you can avoid it. That has been it for Solutions segment. Morning at NTV still continues. Up next is Flavia Tumusime with Take Note, Keep It Here.
Yalama, Amalanyes Kerili Sesenete NTV, Kakero Dele Kenneth, Arutanyum Kurupo NTV, Karina Koteso. Sialam Kutanyes Kerana Sen NTV, Dua Muno Rengese Baga La Jokan, En Numuno Mataka Daya La Jara, Dua Muno Rekarda Le Chela Jokan. Do Asalti Seseni NTV. Yalama.
Spark TV presents the Spark TV.